that will support ARM as a first-class citizen for our server edition. And there's a new generation of ARM hardware coming to market, which has been designed from the ground up for server-type environments. So there's going to be a great deal of innovation there, a great deal of competition and change. But we're certainly going to see that, I think, setting the pace for power density or performance density. One of the things that we're doing a lot of at the moment is building clouds for people, or helping people build clouds. Large hardware providers think that in future it might be worth their while not to sell their hardware, but to rent their hardware, or to make their hardware available for rent. So they're all building public clouds, and we're engaged with a good number of them building out their public cloud offerings. Telcos are saying, well, not only am I going to put a connection down to your premises, but I'll give you the ability to burst your infrastructure needs onto our centralized infrastructure network so you can build hybrid clouds. And we're engaged with a number of telcos, helping them build clouds on Ubuntu and on OpenStack. So we're starting to really understand some of the key changes and trade-offs that happen when you dive into that kind of environment and what you want to achieve from that kind of transition. And one of the key things really is human scalability. You know, we talk about software scalability all the time, but one of the key changes really is human scalability. How do we essentially scale up the reach and effectiveness of the people who are responsible for that infrastructure? And this is a continuation of a theme that we've had for the last sort of 5 years, where operations essentially became much more of an engineering and development exercise than a traditional maintenance type, deployment type exercise. In many of the sort of world's most familiar brands, the ratio of human beings to servers has gone up to 10 or 20 times what it used to be before the Facebook and Google era. So it's becoming really important to sort of think about how many different machines can one person be responsible for. And in the sort of data centers of the future, those ratios are extraordinary, you know, one person to 10,000 machines or higher. In flat type infrastructures, like you can imagine the Google or Facebook infrastructure as being, you know, relatively flat, it's easy to understand that. What's more interesting is to look at a richer, more complex infrastructure, like a typical enterprise IT infrastructure, where you literally have hundreds of different applications that aren't on the sort of flat substrate, and you wonder how you're going to increase the sort of human scalability factor there. Well, in the past, we've seen a lot of work in things like configuration management tools. Puppet will be familiar to people, Chef as a new sort of entrant in that game. And essentially, you can think of those as kind of like extending the arms of your servers, of your system administrators. They still have to think and do all the same sorts of things that they used to have to think and do. It's just that they can now efficiently do it and sort of spray it across more machines. So they can say, right, make this change to this configuration file on all of our machines or on those 10,000 machines over there. So it's kind of like a lever to expand the reach of your system administration or ops team. We've also seen a trend towards thinking about ops as an engineering exercise called DevOps. It's really about defining the language that developers and operations speak more clearly and thinking differently about the handover process. And it's that that really led us to some work that we've driven recently, which I think is probably the most exciting stuff coming out of Canonical and the Ubuntu community around the cloud. The key issue that we identified with those sort of the configuration management approach is that you still suffer ultimately from a certain amount of central planning. You still need in somebody's head a master map of what is where. And so like any sort of large economy that's being centrally planned, it's very difficult to get the inefficiencies out of that environment because it depends ultimately on someone or some system being able to keep in its head, you know, all of the complexity. So for example, if you've got a change that you want to make, someone has to know where that change is going to impact and sort of a reversed dependency problem, what depends on what. And it's a very difficult problem to solve, and it's a very difficult problem to scale. Humans do very well at that, up to a certain point, and then very badly after that. And so when you look at the operations practice, a lot of it is dealing with this fundamental problem. It's a problem that configuration management doesn't really address, because it's not about efficiently getting that change to 10,000 machines. It's about knowing which 10,000 machines need that change, and if you made a change, which other 10,000 machines are going to be, you know, impacted by that. So that's led us to a different way of thinking about service deployment. At an infrastructure level, I think things stay essentially physical. People still will think about compute and network and storage at the infrastructure level. Above that, however, the mental model shifts and it becomes more service and platform as a service-like. And the key thing about infrastructure as a service is that it provides a very clean separation between those layers. It lets you build a team that just worries about infrastructure and lets your operations team start to think in a much more abstract way about the services that they're providing. One of the key drivers for us was this idea of scaling change management, that you should have to scale your system administration team by the number of decisions you want to take, not by the number of places you have to implement those decisions. And that's a fundamentally different way of thinking about it. And so what that means is that you essentially need to be able to isolate every decision and make a decision and execute a decision with confidence, with the system taking care of the deployment or the execution of that decision. So service orchestration essentially blurs the lines between infrastructure and platform as a service. It lets you think about every component as a service. It lets you think about the scalability of a particular service inside that service. It really encapsulates the scalability of service. The tool that I'm describing here, so we think of it as magic for the cloud. So the name that we use for it is Juju, which in the same languages that that Ubuntu comes from means language. Ubuntu means humans, humanity, in the essence of being human, and Juju means sort of the supernatural and magic in those same languages. So magic for the cloud. Somebody described it to me as the same sort of shift in thinking that we got again in the mid-90s when people moved from auto-build, auto-configuration type tools to package management. Instead of trying to make your software build more effectively on multiple different platforms, you define the relationship between the platform and the software. So in a package type environment, each piece of software knows what it depends on. Each piece of software knows what configuration it needs. And when you say, I want to install this piece of software, it pulls in all of the other pieces that you need. So Juju's platform agnostic. You can deploy on AWS, you can deploy on the metal, you can deploy on your workstation with LXC, any kind of underlying substructure. And it gives you a level of service encapsulation that for many people who find the cloud sort of difficult to manage, brings a level of clarity to the conversation between the developers of those services and the ops of those services. It's for me, it's a little bit, the excitement around that is a little bit like the early excitement I remember around Debian and RPM as that packaging story started to emerge in the Linux world. So I hope that serves as some sort of catalyst for thought and debate during the rest of the day and tomorrow. And again, it's a delight to be here. As I said, in the next 5 years, everything will change except for the beauty of Paris.
Thank you.
Stay well.
Thank you very much.